Hello, everyone. Happy Friday. Thank you all for joining the Open Documentation Hour. Haven't really got any updates prepared for you other than to remind you that we're going to be at the Ubuntu Summit at the end of October in The Hague. It'd be great if anyone lives close and would like to make the trip. The Open Documentation Academy, we're just about to get into the next phase of planning for the next 6 months. So it's been just about 6 months now, and you know, it's humbling the amount of interaction and contributions we've had there, and it seems to be doing really well. But please reach out to us if you have any ideas or anything you'd like to change, or if you want to be involved more. You can find us on Matrix or on the discourse forum that we use for most of the discussions, or you know, get in touch with me privately if it's something you're not sure about. But we always want to be open for ideas. This week, really excited, actually. We've got Christian joining us, who's a director at Canonical. I mean, most people server Christian, and Sally's invited him. So thank you, Sally, for convincing Christian to join us. The reason is that we're going to find out, but Christian has a really successful policy on documentation, and it sounds to me like a culture of documentation with the teams that he runs. So I'm really looking forward to this. I'm going to hand it over. I probably need to give you presentation rights. Let me do that first.
I have no slides. All I need is talk.
Well, yeah, okay. Well, I'll hand it over to you, Christian. So thank you.
Yeah, and thank you for the introduction. Obviously, Christian Ehrhardt from Germany. People, we rarely touch deeply enough. So let me do the introduction, at least the one I give to people that I hire or stuff. Like, so I have the most classic, boring German setup you can think of. Two kids, a boy and a girl, a wife. Canonical, working at home, allowed me to go back to where I grew up. So my parents are just 800 meters this way. So it's like as classic German, like, no, I'm not the modern person, even though the job is very much. Thank you, Graham, for the upfront praise of something I'm unsure to fulfill. But yeah, I'm happy to talk. You called it culture. I will eventually, in my mindset, what I think I will call it mindset or something. But anyway, the terms don't matter. I'm actually a Voskau guy, which is the local grocery who is serving primarily local stuff out of a 50-kilometer radius. So support your local store if you can. Conditions apply. Asterisk. You are server team. Yes, I've always been in the server team while in Ubuntu. But on one hand, the server team does very different things today and in the past. And it also has been an incubator of almost everything that is today a team. Like Moss used to be server team, OpenStack used to be server team. Like the list is long. It's just today it's normal. Today you would fund an extra team to start with something. But in the past, when the company was much smaller, incubators were often with us. And to complete this, before I was a mainframe guy in IBM for 11 years. So Big Iron is still with me. I still love it. So friends there, some good connections. So I appreciate that world as well. Today is about documentation, as obviously this title of the session says. And I have a few aspects that I've written up and I'm loosely talk about. Feel free to discuss, feel free to ask. And if you can take anything away that helps you to drive back to your teams, squads, managers, it's good. And if not, I hope it was at least not too boring. So we'll get there. So the first thing I found, which maybe is different in Ubuntu than in other places, and I'm very much a Ubuntu person, even though we have dedicated products as well, is you need to acknowledge that you cannot write everything. And you don't need to. We integrate and facilitate many great upstream projects. Many of them, not all, but many, have great documentation. There is almost zero value in rewriting a documentation that already exists. But what is it that is worth then if you're in any of those departments that utilizes open source, which already has something? What is it that you document? If I say it's not worth to repeat, what is it? And in my opinion, it's three elements that we need to care for. Two are content, so let's get to that. One is, what is actually special? if we modify code or behavior or configuration to make it work together well when we integrate with the other thousands of components, that is the very most important thing to document, because that is what will be different to what people find elsewhere, right? If they find a documentation on an option project, if there's anything different in Ubuntu due to the way how it integrates elsewhere, that is what you need to focus on. Whenever you make a change like that, make sure that is documented. It's much more important than the basic use. Then on the other hand, I mentioned basic use, a bit of a getting started helping hand, so people know even what they want to think about, is helpful, but it's absolutely fine, in my opinion, to then, for deep specific, link out and refer to the upstream things that exist, doing that well. The next, so number one is what is special? Know what is special. And you might be in different projects, but I tell you what, unless you're in a fully commercial, non-open source project, this problem will exist. There will be something somewhere else, and you have to decide where is the most bang for the buck for you locally to do something. Then the next element is what people care about. And that is actually interesting, because today, when you say, what do people care about? The first thing people think, and it's not wrong at all, it's good, it's data. Like, what have they searched? How is your link traversal? What is the referrals? All the data you get. We do it. You do it. It's good. It's helpful to identify that. But there is more. And sometimes I wonder if people, on one hand, people often don't make the connection naturally between fixing a bug and then documenting it. So if somebody writes a feature, it's very natural to say this new feature needs to have some documentation. All pull requests, processes, structures in Teams have something for, you have added this shiny new green light, tell the people how to turn on the green light. There's a thing that people miss. If somebody says, I continue with this green light example, even though it's silly, somebody says, yeah, if your room has this atmosphere, you don't see it well, and the fix is we pump out the atmosphere, that is a bug fix, like a bug report, you fix it, it's done. Rarely do people transfer that into documentation or like a hint. It could be like, hey, if you are in these conditions, have a look. Because that's just like the changes to make Ubuntu special. That is something that you've identified in an environmental or situational condition that is unlikely to be mentioned in general documentation, in what people find on Ask Ubuntu, Reddit, any AI help that generates something. It's the bit that's missing there that is often a problem there. And I laughed so much before when I said people miss something. Old school, talk to people. We try to send, at least to some portion as we can afford it, people to conferences. Conferences, sometimes special interest topic conferences, and sometimes open source ecosystem things like Blumber, StepConf, or whatever you're working in. And just listen openly with an awareness of, usually the brain shuts down after, oh, that's not my problem, but maybe answering the question behind in documentation might help users to get there. So roughly speaking, what is special and what people care about is important. And from there, I realized when thinking about all of this, it's that together then defines what is missing. But this is the content that is missing. Content, what is different, content, what people want and don't find yet. It's all content. But then we come to the culture, mindset, or whatever else that I think need to have. No surprise, time is always scarce, right? So you need to get people to realize, not only to think about those things I mentioned when fixing bug, when talking to people, when going on. If people think they have to immediately document that, that will not work. They might be standing somewhere, doing something else, have to deliver something. But having a healthy, and at least put it in the backlog. We have multiple levels of that. If it's something huge, there's a single card. No need to click 5 minutes through Jira if you hate that. Be my guest. It's like, just open one, add a line, be done. If you're on Launchpad, also easy. So there need to be easy ways to quickly free up your mind again. If you picked up an idea on, oh, that would be good, you need to get rid of that idea into a place that is reevaluated. And that reevaluation is then part of the normal team's process of every now and then we look at that, what is worth to prioritize or put on. And depending on complexity, that needs, in canonical terms, half-year roadmap size things, or just, yeah, go for it on Friday afternoon, whatever applies. But the important bit is try to create an environment where people can realize and not feel pain, but like, yeah, good. We get back to that when it's the right time. Because I mentioned features, documentation is part of it. That's the easy part. But all the other situations where you pick up something, help them to put that into later talk. So that is one element that is missing. And then allowing people the time. I mean, by everything I said now, you set up an infinitely growing backlog that makes you feel bad. When we look back at those things, we have triage duties, which also check our documentation. If people have filed PRs or questions, we handle them. But that's meant to be at most half day thing a week and goes on. And every morning there's a different person on rotation. And that's fine. But sometimes the things identified are more. And that's why I meant we have multiple levels of planning. Then comes the time where I, as a manager, need to go in and say, you know what, while we can't do all of them, me, Sally, and the seniors of the team, look at what is in there and try to pick at least a few and put them at, elevate them to the very same level of importance as any other roadmap epic. So we're not flooding it. That's impossible. We need to find a fair balance. But if you care for the former, then you know, have roughly an idea what would be great to be added. And if you got so far to have this information, don't ignore it. And the discipline there is being able and willing to push back on wishes. There's always more to do. I'm not surprising anyone. And sometimes it's worth to not do the 17th feature, but maybe to 10 and do a bit of technical debt that's breaking you every time. Documentation for where it's most asked and most demanded. And speaking of the Documentation Academy, I really love that. Part of what we invest more next cycle is filling with things we think are great ideas. But here's a trick. I've already reserved a person who has time to review and get that back in, because otherwise you will do work. And then it's like, how does a person feel if they do something and then it's lingering only? So time certainly is part of it. No surprise. I would say actions like the Documentation Academy help with scaling out, because no matter how much I want to consider documentation, we can't write it all. Right? We have thousands of packages. It's just impossible. So projects like this, I highly appreciate. But it comes at many, many stages. For example, there's a local Linux user group. I fail to go there, but I read their mailing list regularly. And sometimes I pick up something and want to go and pick up ideas. And another element that might be worth missing, or people think they are missing, is skill. So many people have a topic they want to contribute, and then they feel like, yeah, but I'm not sure I would do it. yeah. Iqbal, I agree. If you feel you can't complete, that's giving you a bad feeling before you even start. It's not a personal issue. It's just that's normal. But for that particular thing, like the fear of not getting it completed, it's reaching out to others to help or breaking it down into tasks. One of the important things that changed our stance to documentation is do not try to envision the perfect thing. Envision some work that is a few hours that makes it after those few hours better than it was before. And maybe the complex thing takes 200 of these, sure. And or maybe it needs some more allocation, but that's the thing. I'm coming back to the skill question, and that is where we all need to help everybody else that we detect a lack of that. Yes, this program does it. The sheer existence of dedicated authors in Canonical now compared to years ago does it for the whole organization structure. And I appreciate that cross-pollination and learning and being there, because I personally like to get inspired by others doing things, then I immediately go in the same issue as Iqbal, saying, damn it, where's the time? I can't do it. But I break out something. I put in our backlogs. I allocate time, if it's not me, for others to get somewhere. And the very last bit, and that's what's closing the circle, is the mindset. We now mentioned many technical things where you could spot something, how you could improve allocation, how you can make it easier for people when they spot something to make sure it's not lost. We've talked about all that. But at the end of the day, I found that quite often we do it wrong, we as humankind, in handing out orders, like, speaking of documentation, add a paragraph about this configuration here. This person will do it because you told them, sure. But I say, instead of handing out orders, hand out reasons. It's so little extra effort, like, because people often use it this way, we want to add this paragraph because we hope that then we can avoid this effect. This person has a much higher chance to next time make the mental connection when they see something of, that's the same thing. Is that because of this? Let's do that. So it's an example, but as a pattern, it's very true. And it's not limited to documentation either. It's like, try to give reasons. Yes, that sometimes means people speak up, but if we shouldn't hire smart people if we don't want people to get back arguments sometimes. That's really the central thing to get the mindset right, is every time you want something, give out the reasons and follow up if something happened and it was good or bad, follow up. You all often do reviews, helping the teams to get things right. In there, if you can afford it, sometimes don't say font style this size 11. Tell them why, like, don't repeat it 500 times, but we try to be coherent across things. That's why the style guide, it's, by the way, it's here, so you next time know it in advance. Could you do this, please? Anything that we either task someone or review and constructively criticize, wherever you can, adding reasons, in my opinion, helps to get this mindset right for people to do it right in the first place. And secretly, if you go that way over time, people will more and more do themselves. They will come to you and say, what do you think? Should we put that in? And then comes, sadly, my job is like, yes, you're right, but let us put it at the same level of the others. And we select fairly based on priority. Because the moment someone has an idea, I know it from myself, you burn for it. Like, we need this. Ask Sally about man pages. I wish I could steal all of you for half a year and we would make it great. But another day, maybe. And turning that around, there is an anti-pattern that, yay, we'll get there. I believe. I'm a believer. There's an anti-pattern, which I recently saw. I'm sure it was meant well or had some purpose, but the exercise that we had in tracking exactly every hour and minute that people spend in different projects, I have worked hard to get everyone, well, many already were, but to get everyone onto a mindset of they want to think about documentation. If they can, they want to do some. They come to me, could we add at least this into the planning for the cycle? Handing people then the extreme opposite, which is an order of hard tracking without reasoning in detail, was not too helpful to motivation. Sally and I explained a lot, took away the overhead. We have completed it. That's fine. But do you see the difference between my recommendation is give them reasons turning into people wanting to do it, or give them very strict orders, which people will execute exactly what you tell them, but reduce their engagement, if you want to call it that way. And I feel that's my closing thought. So summarizing the top head level things I had in mind was, for us in Ubuntu, it's most important to add something where it's special, because it might exist otherwise anyway, 10 times over. Or where we identify through data or connection, social engineering, what is most asked for, what is most needed. So in a lot of ways, interestingly, those two aspects, the documentation work is exactly like the packaging and coding work. It's integration. You're not writing the book. you're connecting the two books so that people realize, oh, if you think of that and that together, boom. So you're actually doing the same work, but with words instead of code. And last, give people guidance and not commands. But hey, that's my philosophy. I'm happy if everybody else does it different. It worked well for me and us as the team. And Sally is a great partner in crime there. She's never just passing, do that. She's always helping to provide context, which helps us for the team to come back. So when writing my initial thoughts, I thought documentation is great because we need to feed the AI some smart stuff. So if it takes over, when I was young and my first code went into things like kernel or projects, I thought, like, yeah, you know, for my lifetime, things I did will be part of the world. Just as a construction person thinks, that's my bridge, and so many million people would drive over it. With today's LLMs and other things, words are code. They will be in the future actioning. So think twice about every word we add and try to get it well. Nobody interrupted me. It's probably my consistent talking, but
we'll be polite. Thank you so much. That was a really wonderful insight. So if anybody would like to ask a question, please go ahead. Iqbal's saying, which team do you support?
You mean I'm working with support?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Yeah, sure. So I'm personally in the Ubuntu server team, which comes down to three major projects. One, that's why I asked team, because I guessed that.
Oh, yeah, okay.
So for locality reasons, it would be SDFT Kaiserslautern, but let me be honest, if I watch soccer, I watch it to go to sleep, sorry. Handball, much better. My daughter plays it, much more involved. I'm like an officially accredited timekeeper and help there and do stuff. And esports, but yeah. No, it's not Munich. I being raised up as a profound hater of Munich, I really don't hate them, but raised as one. Old world.
So, I have a question maybe to start if anybody else wants to. Do you find it, so in my experience, especially when it comes to crunch time, documentation is often one of the first things to go. When it comes to ticking off, has this objective been done or not? And people want to put that tick in to avoid scrutiny. That will often mean that the documentation will be postponed and then ultimately neglected or forgotten about. How do you counteract that?
I think it has become to be so early. So these crunch time happens naturally to the end of things completing into a release or shipment or something. But that only, statistically, in my opinion, kills documentation over proportional. If you do develop the stuff, test the stuff, and then while we're shipping, write some text. Usually for the two of my three projects that do more classic development, where you think in that these cycles, already the PR adding the feature usually has some elements either associated in the second PR or discussed there. And that's like many weeks before it gets shipped, because that needs to land, it lives in CI. At some point it comes to release, where, by the way, it is rechecked if all the features landed, have like, did they actually got the documentation? It's like a catch point. And at the end, I have seen what you mean. I think we have rarely done that, because it's the same as adding stuff without tests. Can be done. It's quick. But you know what? At the end, you'll pay more in time invested for the thing that slipped. And I believe that's even true for documentation. The people misunderstanding and misusing it. So I think whenever you can, just letting slip the feature, speaking of features, is probably the better choice. Or delaying the release or something. Because without offense, you say it's the easiest victim. It's often also the smallest. Like if you stack up the effort, you have like 30% specking, steering, coordination, 50%-ish development and test and documentation is part of the remaining 20% overhead-ish. In most times, there are different cases, but on average. And that means even if you kill that first, you only gained that much.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I don't have a silver bullet for this particular problem, other than maybe people should feel accountable for all aspects of a feature. Many teams have started to put, does this have the accompanying documentation as part of the landing process? That's certainly something that helps. I mentioned our extra catch, which is like all those things landed over time. But when we then release everything that landed, it's like a look back, like a little retro, like, yeah, is everything mentioned? That's maybe good in case something slipped beforehand. But yeah, the rest is, yeah, decision.
Go for it, Iqbal. So I'll read it out. In some projects, we have a lot of people who want to add documentation, but don't want to or can't bring themselves to use suggested channels. This can be due to unfamiliarity with Git or the dread of contributing publicly.
Okay. I can share my opinion, but I feel that the other authors here are much more suited to answer that. But let me start, since I'm supposed to be the guest here and others add.
He's just added a little bit extra. Do you think we can accommodate those people? Maybe a simple email format, for example, or wiki type edit allowance?
It depends. So wiki type edit has not worked out as good as you think. And in all projects I have, it turned out that Git won by a wide margin over other things. But that might be skewed because I'm owning almost exclusively rather deep tech issues where the people able and willing to contribute are deep tech people, and there's next to no way they didn't see that. I can totally see that people in customer success or front-end development might have a much higher statistical chance to run into the combination of people engaged with your product, willing to help, but not into the tech part. That's just not my world. We have seen the opposite. We had edit style, wiki discourse, and it was like, okay-ish. And since the change to Git, it got much more fitted to the user group that we have. And before others share, hopefully, good suggestions, I think knowing your user group is actually the answer to this very question. Like, know your target audience. What do you expect? And personally, it comes to talking and agreeing. I mean, we have had people just saying, shouldn't there be a talk about that? That is like your email suggestion. And we had other people, here's a PR changing line 17, because that's wrong. Fine. So in my projects, I would encourage, and I hope that people realize, they can just file issues. I mean, that's not knowing the code. That's not knowing the process. Our documentation pages lead to the issue page because all you do is, it says, describe your problem, can be anything. But funneling it that way over email or other things helps to get them all in the same way. Because I've seen sometimes when people reached out through mailing lists on Ubuntu, and we had to say, yeah, you're right. Can you file it here? So it's part of the same triage and process. And many do, fine. Those that can't, we try to help. You know, you shouldn't be ignored if you don't know how. But for those, we then say, okay, I did this for you. Like, we convert that for an issue. But that so often lose the people. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, but I've seen the pattern. I'm gladly living in a place where I'm more to the other extreme. Since I'm speaking, so the answer here is, I've received emails where people want me to add something simple. And while I want to help them, it's just not scalable. Here I have an answer if you want. Again, pick your solution. What works for us for things like that, like an insane amount of small things, could be anything. We at least require them to be issues, like in any sort of tracker. It could be Launchpad, could be GitHub, whatever it is that works for you. And you're right. These mid-sized and the large ones, people think about. This is important. They put it on roadmaps or on time allocations, on documentation academies. If it's actually not important, be fair on triage. Triage includes saying no, unless you do it right away, no. But the in-between, the process that we have established is when we do roadmap planning or other capacity planning along the cycle, we also look at these smaller scale things. And if they accumulate to more than feels comfortable, we sometimes have created time allocations or planning in a way of, this will never get done because it alone does not win. But let's pick the 10 we want most. So Sally, me, the seniors go in, we select a bunch, could be 4, 10, it depends on what it is. And then it fits into sizing. Then it's a 2 or 4 week task because to make all of them, that's there. So we are able to address the most important one by converting it. And if you're a bit into planning, that's just the inverse of normal planning. Normally you get a target which is too big and you have to break it down into workable chunks. And what you're describing is you get many little things which are so small that they never pass the bar of attention. And just as you break down the large ones, you need to accumulate the reasonable small ones to be able to compete on the same level. I mentioned this competing on several level multiple times. At least when it's about capacity planning, that's the only way to go. And the other way to tackle it on our end is that all our teams have triage rotations, and the triage process definition, it's for books, code, and PRs, but it also includes looking after docs, which means every day it's a different person that has some time allocated to be meant to look at those things. And if they are really small, you can often just easy and quick lend them or say no with a reason, if there's a reason. So on one hand, eat the small things while they happen, because once they are stacked up, it's bad. And if they're stacked up, could not just say, sorry, backlog, grab out selected bits every now and then. And again, no silver bullet, just what we do and go for it. But speaking of the authors here, that's something that you can actively drive. If you feel you have such either too huge to be done or too small to care things, you can either break them down or lift them up and combine them. So they suddenly make something on the right scale to be able to be tackled and to be able to be perceived. So if you feel it, that is an option I see. Give it a shot. Don't invest many weeks, but give it a shot what works in your org. Because we're humans. Humans are different for good and bad. Okay.
I don't know if any technical authors want to have a go at their perspective on that. I mean, from the idea of people being perhaps intimidated by the process, I think doing things in public, leading by example, having a welcoming contribution policy, you know, things where people can see how the contributions like theirs have gone, really help set expectations and know what to expect.
Yeah, there's probably something that the people with this anxiety of working in public, they maybe didn't realize that all of us that already do that are ashamed of the stuff they did a year ago or 10 years ago. It's just the thing. If you're not slightly concerned of what you did in the past, it means you didn't learn something, because life makes you learn. Is that structure? Is that code? Is that architecture? Doesn't matter. It usually means that not all, but most of the things when you look back, you would do slightly different. And that's fine. And if somebody else is ahead of the curve in a particular topic, they will help you to get things land in a way. Dan?
Yeah, I think a lot of people get intimidated. Oh, did I lose you? Okay. Yes. I think a lot of people get intimidated by Git. And those that don't, I probably lose 50% of them when it comes time to sign the CLA, because they don't know if they should sign it or not. And, you know, so the pull request just kind of sits there forever. But I did find about 6 months ago, I added a feedback widget to our docs, and I made it so that it would allow a very long feedback field. People could paste code samples, paste error messages, whatever they want. And so I do get good stuff there. And, you know, once a week I go through those, or, you know, one of the writers goes through those and updates the docs based on those comments or complaints. But yeah, GitHub is tough. The product managers that I work with won't use it. They want to use Google Docs to to give feedback. Yeah, it's difficult to get help from people that are afraid of Git, but that's my 4 cents.
I'm happy to hear this, because it helps my perception, because as I mentioned, I'm living in the opposite end. I had people with like allergic reactions to things like this course. Immediately not like leveling up there, but I think it comes down to knowing this target audience. The time when you're really doomed is if your target audience is so wide that you essentially don't need all of them. That might need a bit of an interesting, a more interesting contribution guideline, because you might want to do, if you're this role or this persona or whatever you would describe, go here and there. But yeah, I agree. No surprise. Good one. But it's great to see both extremes mentioned in the call. So people realize if they don't fit in what I say, that's not wrong or something. It's just in a different place in the spectrum of what we work at.
I was just going to add that actually with the Documentation Academy, we were concerned about hosting it on GitHub and expecting people to use Git to be able to contribute. But in fact, you know, I suppose there's a bit of bias in doing that, but when people have the option to use Discourse or do some other way, which is what we do, you know, accept anybody working however they feel most comfortable. Most people are quite happy to kind of use it as a way of getting some Git experience. And in fact, we found more people happy to engage with it that way than previously, such as in Discourse.
I think with docs as code being such a popular topic in the technical writer community, people jump at the chance to people who want to write jump at the chance to use it.
Yeah, and there's also a culture shift. By the way, this is not strictly GitHub. We mentioned that so often, but we say version control over wiki, essentially. You could pick platform if you like. But I think the culture shift that also plays into this is a generational thing. So many people complain about different gen characters that you might want to pick. But I can tell you that I didn't have computer science in like eighth grade or something, and that happens nowadays quite often. They will not come out as computer science specialists, but they will have much less, they will be much less unused to structures like version control and other elements. So so many other things have changed over time. Maybe that disinvolvement might also further slip away to get better. Maybe that tells us that project managers that you said are not wanting to use it are all too old. Age discrimination by tools, new problem. Yeah, let's go for it.
Now, you may be able to tell that I'm very sensitive to age discrimination from the look of me.
Yeah.
If anybody else has any questions, please feel free. I'm tempted to leave a few seconds of an awkward silence to see if we can prompt anyone to ask anything. Because I've got a couple more, but so if you want to save yourself from a couple of more of my questions, then. So one question I do have, Christian, is that did your teams have this mindset when you started, or is it something that they've developed over time?
It's weird to answer, because when I started, we were like two people trying to do the same. We now try to do with many, many more. I think we partially had the mindset and wanted to extend on it. And that's not limited to this. So the initial times were a lot about let's structure what we desire. While we are unable to do it all, let's structure what we desire. And that included testing, like any quality thing. It included documentation. It included more process rigor, elements like that. And in these early times, it was like scratching, getting the things together. But defining what we would want allowed us to then slowly but surely eat into those elements, like how much care can we spend for documentation? How much care can we spend for processes and other elements? And that became more an internal mindset thing. But honestly, I think everyone we hired over time and joined the team, that just came to a group that already expressed part of our desire is this, and documentation was part of that. So that quickly went somewhere to also include the new people. So yeah, if you want to say I had an easy start because the people already kind of desired it, yes, I would say so.
Have you ever had to change minds?
Yeah, in regard, mostly in regard to these, when is it worth and when is it not worth? Those are classic decisions. I mentioned that if you identified something, you are quite hot on this particular idea. And I mentioned like these example of you're right, but let's put it aside everything else to be fairly evaluated on something. That is something that happens every now and then. And goes both ways, from convincing, yes, but if we compare, those other still win. So let's put it there. It's fair, but not. And it goes sometimes the other way, which is like, we really need this. And the only capacity we have is you. So, and we talked about giving reasons instead of order. It's not just, and that's it. It's then like, that is why we think we need it and how you feel and so on. And we either get people that are invested because otherwise the output is not great. Mm. Or we ended up somebody else while listening to it is like, actually, I really like it now. And then we trade things among squad. Like I go by priority and preference. So if among the highest priority, we are not doing like fractional priority planning. Like, there are a few groups, but if it's among the highest, we can select by preference. Sometimes my quote when I joined Launchpad in, like, I don't know, 15 years ago, that I created was, in the past, I was told I need to stick to priorities, but today everything is priority one, so I can do what I want. And I thought that's quite a smart thing, but in hindsight, yes, everything is priority one, but it does not make me happier. So it's making things harder sometimes.
Does it mean that when you hire engineers, they need to be able to write?
No. I have not yet met an engineer that is unable to write. Maybe unwilling or not yet believing they could. But since I'm mostly speaking to authors, as much as you might sometimes think, I don't get the details of this, I can't review or write, engineers tend to think, I can't write about this because my words are clumsy or something. Give it a shot, you'll find it's fair. And I mentioned before, part of the mindset needs to be, is it better than before? Don't go for perfection. That is what is the biggest setback of, I couldn't write this perfect thing. Yeah. Me neither. Just never love my writing. But it's better than before. Yeah, absolutely. And the diversion of disciplines that we now have, authors who are very much specialized in style, structure, words, and engineers which are specialized in deep understanding of, this word actually could be read this way in this context means something else. Work together is probably the real outcome, real solution to that. But yeah, I'm not selecting on documentation ability because I haven't found anyone who is not. It's then convincing with reasons again, and giving it a try, and realizing it was not so painful.
I don't want to take up any too much more of your time, actually, Christian. I've got perhaps, if anybody wants to get a question in, please give it a go. I've perhaps got one last question that I would, while we've got you here, and it's really about, have you ever had? I think that writing good documentation is incredibly difficult, but I meet quite a few people who think the opposite, that thinks that it should be easy or it should be quick. And especially in, you know, when I first started at Canonical, I felt insecure about saying that something was taking so much thought or required so much time. And I'd love to know what your thoughts on that are.
I think I answered them before by the two aspects of break large things down. If it's hard, it's hard because you think of the huge element. Break it down. And the other aspect is what I mentioned is it better than before? So it's also a perception issue. If you only think of one huge block and you lock yourself away for 4 weeks, you might have the outcome. The thing is good. But everybody in your team, squad, peers, something will say, I never see him. He's not talking to us and not doing anything. So breaking down not only makes it more doable, but also helps you to not go silent and isolated. I naturally come more from coding, but I think I cannot even count the situations I've seen where people went away and do just their thing too much. And then at review found like, right, if only I would have known that after the first. So if your question is documentation hard or easy? I think the answer is do something and don't care if it's hard or easy. And that's because what will the answer to the question solve for you?
Feeling guilty for spending a day making barely any difference to a document or making any progress.
And no. Yeah, okay, I got you. But if you can explain what you've done and why, I mean, start to yourself and to others in extension, then you shouldn't feel guilty. And again, not limited to writing. People sometimes spend 3 days on debugging something that when it comes out is super silly. They feel just the same as like, I wasted this time and all the others. Let's use a minute to talk about a big issue in remote work and remote communities that don't work together, which is very closely tied to your I feel guilty for things. Self-imposter syndrome is very statistically much more present in any remote work environment for a perceptional bias, which is you are in part of any group, authors, team, anywhere. You will always perceive the one or two people that just had their spike of getting something done and compare your average day of, if you get every 5 days something big and one day really sucks and 3 days normal, you will statistically compare a normalish day to one or two people mentioning something really impressive. And you will feel even worse. If you already went in and had your concerns, you will feel worse. And the problem is everybody does this to everyone else. You sometimes come by and you show, finally got this. Somebody else sits there and does it again. It's a big investment in self-reflection as a central problem or danger in remote work to have this misperception. What helps me is write up what you did. At the end of the day, I feel often bad for not having done something. But when I look back in my log of what I've done, it's like, I know many people that couldn't do this in 2 days, and that shall give you some good feeling. But that's, again, my way. Pick anything. But for everyone, for their benefit, like criticizing themselves too hard for having a bias on comparison is a remote work issue. be careful about that.
Thank you so much. That was a great way to end. Really appreciate your time. Thank you so much, Sally, for convincing Christian to take part. I'll mention next week, I volunteered myself to talk about something about old synthesizer manuals and documentation, which I've yet to put my thoughts together on yet, but that'll be next week's. I'm going to stop the recording. Thank you all for joining. If anybody wants to stay after this, I don't mind answering their questions if they'd rather those questions weren't part of the recording, but I'll see you in a minute.
Thanks for listening. I hope it was entertaining. And if it was not, I hope you did something good in the side quest.